And let's share the slide. Okay, this lecture is, I think, quite important and a bit dense. We're going to prove some theorem about invertible matrices, which I promised to prove long time ago. If you remember, I mentioned several times already that if AB equal identity matrix and AB are square matrices of same size, then BA also equals identity matrix, which is not obvious. But now we have a powerful tool to prove this, which is rank nullity theorem. And we're going to do this. And then we'll overview theory of determinants. Determinants is a very big topic. It's actually very hard to squeeze it in one lecture and even in several lectures. It's actually a big topic. So we're going to list many properties of determinants without proofs, and proofs are not going to be included in the lecture notes. So you're encouraged to look for the detailed proofs in the pool book or in other books. So it's a popular topic. You can find a lot of nice sources where you can find it, but we only gonna overview it and study its basic properties, and some of them without any proofs. Yeah, but it's useful to know how to apply determinants. And you already probably met determinants in high school, some of you. Okay, and we mentioned already determinants for 2x2 matrix already, so this topic should not be very new to you. Okay, first let me state this theorem. Basically, it looks a bit scary, but it is not so scary as it may look like. Here I listed more or less in random order a lot of different equivalent conditions for a square matrix to be invertible. So the first condition is basically it's just a definition: matrix invertible if there exists matrix B such that AB equal identity and BA equal identity. Second condition is basically only half of a definition. So if AB equal identity and AB are square matrices, then this implies that A is invertible. Basically, this means that BA is also identity. And then there are a lot of other conditions. We don't have time to go over these conditions in details because there's a lot of logical implications. There's too many conditions, like 11. And actually, if you wish, you can cook up more equivalent conditions. So maybe up to 20, I think. So there's a, but all of them are going to be roughly the same. Okay, so let's do this. On the next slide, I will prove that this condition, condition two, is equivalent to condition A, as promised. But maybe before this, we can prove one or two of these other conditions, which basically you like me to prove. I cannot prove 11. We don't have time for this. Just please in the chat type, if you wish to see the proof of some of this condition, for example, if you want one of this that equivalence of one, then just type in the chat which proof you want to see. For example, you can chat proof 3 or proof 7, whatever, or proof 11. Yeah. If you want to see this proof, if you don't, just okay, don't type anything. If you want to see some proofs, then we can stop using slides and I will prove this condition for you. Yeah, okay, just if you like to see proofs of one of this. No? Okay, someone? Three, okay. kernel is zero. So let me good. Thank you very much. Let me stop for a second. Let me open a whiteboard. Okay. So first condition, matrix is invertible. It means there exists matrix B such that you have this and you have this. Everything here is N times N matrices. And this condition three, the kernel of A is zero. It's a zero vector. Okay, this is equivalent. Let's first prove this direction. Okay, people keep joining. So I strongly advise for the future, don't be late, because I have to actually, I'll let you from the waiting room, let you to join the session. I have to click all the time. Yeah. Okay, good. Let's prove this condition. So we assume this. This is we have in this case. And we want to prove this. This is what we want. Okay. I already mentioned several times that by some strange reason I like proofs by contradiction. I don't know, just maybe my style. So let me suppose that this is wrong. Suppose kernel is not zero. Yeah, so what does it mean? It means that there exists non-zero vector in Rn such that AV is zero. It's by definition. Kernel is all vectors such that if you multiply them by a matrix on the left, you get zero. Okay, let's try to use this to derive a contradiction. How to do this? I mean, this is what we want. We have to use what we have. Okay, how? We basically can do what your subconscious wants to do. We just multiply by B. Yeah, this is true. Then you multiply left-hand side and the right-hand side by B. So you have B A V equal B zero. But if you multiply any matrix by zero vector, of course you get zero. Just use properties of multiplication. So this is zero. But BA is by assumption is identity. Yeah. So identity times any vector is this vector. So we prove that V is zero. Contradiction. Of course, you don't need to use this logic deriving contradiction here. You can just do it in direct proof. You take a vector and the kernel, by definition, it means this, and then you derive it zero. But somehow I just get used to proofs when I suppose that something is not true, and then I derive a contradiction. This is the old habit. Okay, good. So we prove this. We prove this arrow. This arrow is proved. Now let us prove the opposite arrow. Yeah, which may be a bit more difficult. So we now assume that the kernel of A is zero. And then we want to show, this is what we want. We want to show that there exists matrix B, N times N, such that AB equal identity. And BA equal identity. Okay, let me cheat a little bit that I only prove one of this. Yeah, I only prove one of this. Why? Because I already mentioned that on the next slide, I'm going to prove that these two conditions are equivalent, this and that. Are equivalent thing. I promised to prove this long time ago. We're going to prove it in a second. So it's a part of the same theorem. So let me postpone it. So let me now only prove this condition. Okay, in mathematics, it's often you have this law or preservation of difficulties. If something is difficult to prove, you cannot get a simple proof unless you use some result which is difficult to prove. So what I want to say, this error is not so easy. So we have to use something. Okay, so let me use tool that we have. Let me use the rank nullity theorem. Using the rank nullity theorem, I deduce that the rank of A is n. Yeah, because a rank plus dimension of the kernel, which is nullity, is n. Your kernel by assumption, this is what we have now. Your kernel is zero. So this means that its dimension is zero. So by rank nullity theorem, rank A is n. So what does it mean? It means that columns of A span the whole Rn. Column space, it's a span of columns. If its rank is the dimension of this space, so its dimension is n, but it lives in the n dimensional space Rn. So it means it's the whole thing. So we have this. Okay, in particular, all the standard vectors E1, 1, 0, 0, 0, blah, 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 E2, 0, 1, 0, blah, blah, blah. It'll keep joining, yeah. All of these vectors, En, all of them contained in the column space. All vectors in Rn contained in the column space. So I can take a combination of columns of A, a linear combination of columns of A, and I get vector E1. I can take another linear combination of columns of A, and I get vector E2. But I already mentioned, this is a very powerful observation, that taking the linear combination of columns of A is the same as multiplying A by some vector whose coordinates are exactly coefficients of this linear combination. So this means that there exist vectors, the vector V1, such that AV1 is E1. This basically means, this equality means, I can find numbers, lambda 1, lambda 2, up to lambda n, such that if I take linear combinations of columns of A with coefficients lambda 1, lambda 2, lambda n, add them together, I get E1. But I can shortcut it in this way. This is the same thing. Absolutely the same way, there exists vector V2 such that AV2 is E2 and blah, blah, blah. There exists vector Vn such that A times Vn is En. Now I take the matrix B to be the matrix whose columns are the vectors I just found. V1, V2, V3, Vn. I cook up this matrix, yeah. Good. I claim that this is my matrix B. Now, I just multiply A times B, but I already mentioned several times when you multiply one matrix by another matrix in this order, it is the same thing as to multiply all columns of matrix B by matrix A. So this is the same as AV1, AV2, blah, 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 AVN. But by our choice, AV1 is E1, AV2 is E2, and AVN is EN. So I get the matrix E1, E2, blah, 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 EN. But this is exactly identity matrix. So it's exactly what I want. I proved this. And this implies this. We're going to see this in 1 second. Okay, good. Any question about the proof of this on this slide? If you have a question, feel free to type in the chat or type directly to me or just ask. Because if no questions, we go back to slides. Okay, no questions. Fine. So now let me share the slides again. Okay, so we proved that this condition is equivalent to this condition modulo this condition. So if we know that 2 is equivalent to 1, then we already proved that 1 is equivalent to 3. Okay, let's just prove that 1 is equivalent to 2. Okay, so basically I take 2 matrices, A and B, both square. I assume that AB is identity. I claim that BA is also identity. Okay, the proof in some sense quite similar to what we just did. So let me slowly explain it. So I denote this matrix by C. I want to show that this C is identity. Again, my old bad habit. I suppose that this is not true. And then I slowly derive a contradiction. Again, this is just my style. I encourage you to use different approach. Maybe it's probably better. So to try to find direct proofs, it's probably more natural, but I just like this way. Okay, we suppose that C is not identity. Okay, and let's slowly derive contradiction. If we derive a contradiction, then we prove what we want, that C is identity. So look, I multiply C by A. I rewrite it like this, yeah. Then I rewrite it like this because product of matrices, multiplication of matrices is associative. I can put brackets in the any way I want. Yeah, but now I know that AB is identity by assumption. So I get identity here times A, and this is A. And then I subtract A from the left-hand side and from the right-hand side, and then I put A outside of brackets, I factorize it, and this becomes this. Yeah. So A times C minus identity N minus identity is 0. But look, this matrix is not a 0 matrix by assumption. If it was 0 matrix, it means C is identity, but C is not identity. So this is not a 0 matrix. It means at least one of its columns is not 0. But when you multiply A by this matrix, what you just basically do, you multiply each columns of this matrix by A, and you get 0. So it means you take this non-zero column of matrix C minus I, multiply by A, and you get 0. It means this column is in the kernel, and it's not 0. So it means kernel is not 0. We already saw on the previous, not slide, but on the whiteboard, that this condition implies that A is not invertible. Let me just repeat it. Yeah, you can actually repeat it in diff, but to be precise, I cannot use exactly the same proof which I did, because if you remember, I use this to prove this, but I actually want to use this to prove this. So this is exactly what I omitted in the whiteboard. So let me just continue. So I cannot, otherwise I'm gonna have this logical loop. So let me just slowly derive a contradiction from here. So kernel is not 0. Yeah. Since kernel is not 0, rank of the matrix by rank nullity theorem is actually less than n. So it means dimension of the column space is less than n. Let me remind you that dimension of the column space is a, can be the column space It's a linear combination of all columns. It's a span of columns of A. I can rewrite it in the matrix weights, like all vectors in Rn such that Y, Y is A times X, where X is in Rn. So when I multiply A by a vector, I get linear combination of columns of A. So when X runs through vectors in Rn, Y runs through all vectors in the column space. Yeah, but as I already, now I basically what I'm doing this line, I'm reversing the logic of what I wrote in the whiteboard. In the whiteboard, I said, okay, so column space is n dimensional, then it contains E1, En. Now I'm doing opposite. I basically read this line backwards. I said, this is a column space, but it means AB equal En. It means if I take the first column of B and multiply by A, I get E1. If I take a second column of B and multiply by by A, I get E2 because of this equality. This is exactly what we did in the whiteboard. And then this means this equality implies that column of A contains all the standard basis vectors E1, E2, En. But this means its dimension is N. It means column space of A is a whole space Rn, because if this space contains this vector, this vector span Rn. But I already mentioned that by the rank nullity theorem, column space cannot be Rn. Dimension of the column space is n minus dimension of the kernel. Kernel is not zero, so its dimension is positive. So I get a contradiction. Okay, so this is similar to what we did in the whiteboard, maybe a little bit more complicated, but basically, this is what I promised, and we proved this. And I should mention that this is not this this assertion cannot be proved just by manipulation with multiplication. If AB is identity, if you play with this matrices without using any big results, you're probably not going to be able to prove that BA is identity. You really need to use something. In this case, something is rank nullity theorem. And as I mentioned last lecture, rank nullity theorem is very useful. It's a very powerful tool. You can use it to prove many nice results. Okay. Basically, this is more or less everything I want to tell you about invertible matrices in this lecture, because this is a very useful observation. Because if you want to prove that matrix is invertible, you need to find matrix B such that AB equal identity. You don't need to check both equalities. Basically, it saves you half of the work. Yeah, but it's very natural. So we usually use this property without thinking, subconsciously. So, okay. So this was good. So let's continue to new topic. New topic, as I already mentioned. Okay, by the way, before we go to new topic, let me ask you, do you have a question about this proof or question about invertibility? If you wish, we can a little bit discuss it more. If you want. So it's basically up to you. If you have some question about this proof, is something unclear, feel free to ask now in the chat to me directly, or such that everyone can see, or you can just ask. Basically, feel free to ask. This is absolutely okay. Okay, let's wait a second. So there's nothing in the chat. So if you don't have any questions about the proof, let's proceed to the next topic, determinants. And let me remind you that after lectures, I always stay and answer your questions, so you can ask some questions after the lecture. There's no problem. So yesterday was exception. Yesterday was a fire alarm. So I had to leave the building. Okay, good. Determinants. We already mentioned that if you have 2x2 matrix, then its determinant is basically given by this formula, AD minus BC. Usually determinant is denoted like this. In some books, determinant is also denoted by this double vertical arrows. So for example, in many old books on algebra, this is very common. And it's also space consuming. You don't need to put that everywhere. You just put this double arrows. Yeah, okay. So this is a formula for 2x2 determinants. And basically, I think, as far as I understand from the tutorials, most of you know this formula and already met somewhere. So, and this formula is so useful and so oftenly used that if you just see somewhere matrix ABCD, your subconscious always tell you AD minus BC. So this is for many people, this is just in subconscious. Because people solve a lot of problems with this formula. Yeah. For n equal 3, we have another formula, which is a bit more complicated, but you see this formula is inductive. And many of you probably also met this formula. And if you look at both formulas, you can actually guess the way how to inductively compute determinants of any square matrix. So inductively, I mean, if you know the formula for determinant of 2x2 matrices, you can derive a formula for 3x3. If you know the formula for determinants for 3x3 matrix, you can cook up the formula for 4x4. Okay, you see what we're doing here. We take, for example, A11. I take the first row. I take the first element of the matrix in the first row, and then I multiply it by what? By the determinant of the determinant of the matrix obtained from A by removing the first column and the first row. So yeah, I take this element, I erase this column, erase this row, I take the remaining 2x2 matrix, take its determinant and put here. Then I go to the next entry in the first row, but then I do the same, but I change the sign. So it's always like plus, minus, plus, minus. We call it alternating sum. So it's like a sum where you change signs every time. Plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, minus, plus. Yeah, you do the same trick. You take A12 and you multiply it by the determinant of a matrix obtained from matrix A by removing second column and the same row. Yeah, you have matrix, you remove this and you remove this. And you get this matrix, take its determinant. And then you do the same with the last entry. You removed this column, this row, take this matrix, multiply, take a determinant, multiply by A13 and take plus. Absolutely the same trick can be used for n times n, and you can inductively compute determinants. But to be precise, you can use this formula as a definition of determinant. There are many ways how you can define determinants. In different books, determinants are defined in different ways. In some books, determinants are defined using the properties. In some books, determinants are defined using this formula, and then you derive many properties. So there's a lot of different ways. So we, for simplicity, gonna define determinant for n times n matrix using this inductive formula. This is just probably the most straightforward way of doing this. Yeah, so you take n times n matrix, you take i's row, j's column, and you remove this row and this column from the matrix A, And the resultant matrix is n minus 1 times n minus 1. It's also square. And we call the resultant matrix Aij, like this. Yeah. And then we can define determinant using this formula, which I just explained. You take alternating sum on elements in the first row, multiply by the determinant of the matrix A1j, and you take a sum from j from 1 to n. So you go through all these elements, and while you going through this row, you remove corresponding column and you remove the first row. You take the remaining matrix, take its determinant, multiply by this element in the first row, and then multiply by minus 1 to the power 1 plus j. So it means you start with plus and then minus, plus, minus, plus, minus, plus, minus, always. So this is one way how to define determinant. Of course, you can ask me why we choose the first row, or why we choose a row, why we didn't choose a column. And of course, we could choose any row, and we can choose any column, and we can do the same trick. We can use the same formula with any row and with any column. And we basically gonna get the same number, but this is not obvious. You can derive this from this formula. Basically, you can accurately prove that if you define determinant in this way, then the number you get, it's gonna be basically the same if instead of the first row, you get any other row. But you have to adjust this minus one, the power of minus one. So when you see this matrix, you basically can put everywhere, instead of entry of this matrix, plus or minus. So for example, in alternative way, plus here, minus here, plus here, minus here, and then you go. So it's always going to be plus, and all two neighbors are minus, and then plus, minus, plus, minus. So this is exactly the sign you have to put here. Okay, good. So let me list some properties of determinants. First property is exactly what I just said. Then instead of taking the first row, you can take any row. Then you get this formula. This is the same formula as on the previous slide, but you replace, you take ith row instead of the first row. And you get absolutely the same formula. If you substitute here I to be one, you get definition we gave on the previous slide. Absolutely in the same way, you can replace rows by columns. Yeah, sometimes actually it's more psychologically convenient. You just take the first column instead of the first row. It's going to be the same. But why this proposition is important? So first of all, this is not obvious. You have to derive all of these equalities from the formula on the previous slide. This is way beyond the scope of this lecture. And we actually don't have the proofs in the lecture notes. This topic not going to be assessed. I mean, this is not what exactly what I said. You're going to use determinant in the exam and the homework, but I will never ask you to prove these formulas. You don't need to. I mean, it's better if you read the proof, if you have time. But basically, to succeed in this course, you don't need to know the proof. Yeah. But what you have to learn, how to use this formula. And it's quite clear why we need these formulas, why formula on the definition on the previous slide is not enough. Because in some cases, when you want to apply this formula, it gives you freedom of choosing the row or column which you like. And for example, if this row or column contains a lot of zeros, it probably means that it's going to be easier to choose this column or this row, because most of this entry is going to be zero and your sum is not going to be too long to compute. So basically, this is it. Okay, some further properties you can check by using this any formula, like, for example, using the definition, the determinant of identity matrix is 1. It follows immediately from the definition we gave. Absolutely in the same way, but less obvious. So if you have, you can show that if you have a, what is called diagonal matrix, this is a matrix where all elements outside of diagonal are 0. And on diagonal, you have some numbers lambda 1, lambda n. So determinant of such matrix is just a product of diagonal elements. This follows from the formula we used as a definition for determinant. Yeah. For example, I want to expand my formula by the first column. I take lambda 1, multiply by determinant of this. This is n minus 1 times n minus 1 matrix. I already know this equality by induction. And then you get all zeros. So basically, your sum in the definition of determinant collapse to one element, lambda 1 times determinant of this. And then inductively, you get this answer. Okay, this is, for example, example how to compute determinant, for example, 4x4 matrix. You have this 4x4 matrix. It may look a bit ugly, but then you notice that third column consists almost of all zeros. You have only one non-zero number here. So this is a good sign to choose this column for the expansion formula. You take this column and I apply a formula on the previous slide with respect to this column. Again, you say plus minus plus, you take plus 0 times something, which is 0, minus 3 times the determinant of this matrix. What this matrix is? It's a matrix obtained from this matrix by removing this column and this row. And then you get all other zeros, yeah? So now you have to expand this, but you can do this again. For example, you can choose last row because this last row contains only two non-zero entries and this guy is 0. You have this number, you simplify, you get 150. Of course, every computer algebra package in the world is capable of computing determinant of any n times n matrix. But I strongly advise you to compute few determinants by yourself without using computer or some advanced technology, because actually I think it's good for you. You get used to these determinants, how they behave and something. So this should be part of your daily life this semester. Okay, good. Let me list some basic properties of determinants which are useful and which also can be used to compute determinant in some cases. So if you have this A, it's n times n matrix with columns V1, Vn. So first important property, which can be derived from definition, if you take two columns and you swap them, then determinant change sign. Yeah. This actually not obvious, but it follows from this formula. If in this formula, you swap, for example, first and the second column, you can check that again by, you have to use a little bit induction, but you can check that all this, you get the same sum, but sign's gonna change. So this is not obvious, but I strongly advise to check this for small matrices, like 2x2 or 3x3. And you see that this is indeed correct. This is probably the most important property of determinant. Yeah. Also, if you take matrix A, you take one column and you multiply all the entries by some number lambda. Then determinant of the resultant matrix is just lambda times determinant of the original matrix. Again, this follows from the formula used in the definition of determinant. You just, for example, to make it shortcut, you can actually use the fact that you can expand my determinant using this ith column, and then formula becomes immediate. You have this entries of this column times determinant of the matrix, which doesn't have this column at all. So when you multiply entries of this column by lambda, your sum multiplied by lambda. Okay, property one implies, for example, that property two implies that if you have a column consisting of zeros, so you have a zero column, then determinant is zero. This can be derived from the expansion of your determinant by this column or from property two. Yeah, because if you multiply zero column by any number, you get a zero column. So you get the same. So it basically means that lambda times determinant of A is determinant of A for any lambda in this case. But this only possible if determinant of A is zero. Okay, and this is probably the most important property of determinants after one, or maybe even more important than property one. It's a little bit written in too technical way, but what I wanted to say here, that if you have a matrix, if you have basically matrix C, such that you take one column and you split this column into sum of two vectors, then you can cook up two matrices out of C. One matrix which can have the same other columns, but this column can, okay, maybe let me write this down since it's important. It's easy if I write this down. Let me just give you an example. It basically works like this. Let me consider 2 by 2 case. Suppose you have A plus A prime, B plus B prime, C, D. If you have matrix like this, yeah. Then what is determinant of this? We know that this is A plus A prime times D minus C times B plus B prime. Yeah, so this is nothing but determinant of matrix ACBD plus determinant of the matrix A prime B prime CD. Yeah. So if you have two matrices such that they almost identical, but they only differ in one column. Yeah, and you compute the determinant, you add them, and this is the same as determinant of this matrix. But you can do this trick only for one column or one row once. So basically when you do it, it's only at the moment you don't do it once. Yeah. So again, the proof is essentially you expand the determinant by this column and you use a formula for the expansion. But this is very useful. Okay, why these properties are useful? This four, okay, three properties, 1, 3, and 4. Why are they so important? Because you can actually define determinants using these four, three properties plus another one. So basically, if you define determinant as some function on matrices, which satisfy property 1, property 2, and property 4, this defines determinant almost uniquely up to scaling. Of course, if you take this function and multiply by 2, all these properties going to be the same. So then you can, in order to fix the scaling, you need also to add another property. What is determinant of identity? And then you can actually put it as by definition, determinant of identity is 1. And then these four properties uniquely determine the uniquely determined determinant. So this is going, there's only one function like this exists, and it is determinant. This is the way how determinant is defined in some books. And then you can derive the formula for the expansion using these four properties. Okay, and the most, okay, I say the most important property several times because it's actually sometimes it's not easy to see which properties is more important. Probably property 1, 2, and 4 are the most fundamental. They can be used as defining properties of determinants. But the most handy one is probably property 5, which looks like a miracle. The determinant of a product of two matrices. It's a product of determinants. This is mega useful property. It's probably not as fundamental as 1, 2, and 4. Sorry, but it's very, very, very useful, as we will see. And determinant of transpose or transpose of the matrix is the same as determinant of A, but basically this more or less follows from the proposition where I said that you can use columns or rows in the same way. Okay, good. So further properties, which you can derive, now you can use these properties and you can take them for granted. You don't need to prove them if you wish. It's a good exercise, try to prove them. Some of them are okay, some of them is actually quite difficult. For 2 by 2 and 3 by 3, all of these properties you can check by hands. This is not a big deal. Yeah, but what I want to say that now you can use this property to derive more properties. For example, if you have a matrix with two identical columns, determinant is zero. Why? Because you swap those two columns and the sign of determinant must change. But you get the same matrix. So it means in this case, determinant of A is minus determinant of A. This only possible if it's zero. Likewise, is if A is invertible, then determinant is cannot be zero, and determinant of A inverse, it's an inverse of determinant. This follows immediately from this property and the fact that determinant of identity is one. Yeah, because if AB is identity, then this is one, and you get exactly what is stated here. Another lemma, which is less obvious, but it can be derived from this property and this property slowly. That if you have a matrix whose rank is less than n, then determinant of A is zero. So if you have a matrix whose columns linearly dependent, then determinant is zero. So we don't have time to prove this now, but proof is actually not so difficult. But if you wish to see the proof, ask me after the lecture and we'll go over it. Or you can read it in the lecture notes. Okay, and now probably the most useful thing of application of determinants is a formula for the inverse of a matrix, which generalize formula we used in 2 by 2 case. Okay, to do this, let me give some definitions. Let me use for matrix A, I can cook up the matrix Aij as I did in the definition of determinants. You remove I throw in j's column. You compute this determinant, and then you multiply this number by minus I to the power of I plus j. This is exactly plus minus one pattern, which I explained. Your matrix A give you the pattern, plus one, minus one, you put just the plus minus in different entries in such a way that all neighboring ones always plus minus, and you start with plus A. Okay. So then you get bunch of numbers, exactly as many numbers as entries of your matrix. Yeah, a lot of computation. Here you have to compute n squared determinants of n squared n minus one times n minus one matrices. A lot of computations. You put them into the matrix, but in such a way that I's J's entry is not Cij, but Cji. So basically, you sort of transpose the matrix whose contains these numbers as entries. And then the resulting matrix you called adjugate. And then the most important property of determinant, that if you take A times adjugate, you get identity multiplied by determinant of A. This is the most powerful application of determinants. It is used in many, many theorems, in proofs of many, many theorems in algebra. This is very powerful. It's very theoretical. I'm not sure I know any practical usage of this, but this is very powerful. This proposition immediately gives you the formula for the inverse of A. Yeah, you just need to take this adjugate matrix and divide by determinant. And for 2x2 case, you get exactly the formula for the inverse of the matrix we discussed in tutorial one. And this proposition gives you the corollary that rank of A is n if and only if determinant is not zero, if and only if matrix is invertible. Okay, it was a bit too fast for such a big topic, but let me stop the lecture because we run out of time. But if you want to clarify something or to give me more details of something, you can ask after the lecture. Okay, let me stop recording.